Thank you for the invitation. It's a pleasure to tell you on experience in the EU, and I hope it's useful to reflect on your own approach to control Salmonella. My name is Chris de Smet. I'm a veterinarian by education. I'm working in the European Commission for about 20 years on food hygiene and foodborne zoonosis control. Before that, I was a researcher at the University of Ghent in Belgium, and I worked 10 years in a private company dealing with poultry meat production. On this slide, you see an overview of what I'm going to present. Well, in fact, Salmonella control in poultry contains a number of preventive measures based on good hygiene practices and procedures based on the HACCP principles, in addition to some specific rules that we have on the hygiene of poultry meat, eggs, egg products, for example, temperature conditions. However, today I will only present specific Salmonella control measures, which are mainly at primary production, but with some links to microbial criteria in poultry meat, so after primary production. Just to avoid some problem wording, sometimes we use different wording. The wording you see here is the wording I'm going to use for the presentation. That's also the word you will find in EU legislation, just for clarity, in case you are used to use other wordings. These are data from 2005, as you can see, on Salmonella in the EU. It's more or less the starting point from the implementation of Salmonella controls in the EU, although programs for breeding hens already existed. 2005 is also the first year on which the European Food Safety Authority, together with the European CDC, published a first annual report on zoonosis monitoring, and from which data were collected more or less from the same member states as we have today, because there have been some changes in member state, but from then on, it's still comparable to what we have today. The sampling and the analysis nor the reporting were already harmonized at that stage. You see some data. We had that year 170,000 reported human cases of salmonellosis. We came from about 200,000 in the years before that. And well, you will see my presentation, I pay quite some attention to data from foodborne outbreaks. So here you have some data on that. Also in 2005, well, I already said that foodborne outbreak data play an important role, especially in the evaluation of sources of foodborne outbreak. Outbreak investigation in Europe became mandatory in 2007, but not in all cases. Even if you do the investigation, you can identify the source. It could be that, for example, the food is no longer available for sampling when the infection has been diagnosed in humans. So the data you see here from 2005, in about 40% of the outbreaks, we were able to identify the source. So there are quite a number of cases where we could not identify the source. When the source was now, well, here you have the percentage of the different sources. So eggs represented 37% of all cases of Salmonella outbreaks. And you see some other foods that was identified as the odd source. In the other column, you see what serotypes were found in humans, in all human cases. So you see that 70% was enteritidis and 13% Typhimurium. I just show you to justify why the European control program mainly focused on eggs, because they were the main source of salmonellosis in Europe. And they focus on these two serotypes, the first two ones, enteritidis, Typhimurium, because they represent over, at that time, over 80% of all human salmonellosis cases. Yeah. So this is an overview of the approach that we use for each group of poultry. For the breeding hen, the laying hen, the broilers, the breeding turkeys, and the fattening turkeys. Each time we started with a baseline survey because we did not know the prevalence, or we could not compare the prevalence of Salmonella in these flocks in all the member states. So we asked them to carry out the same sampling, analyze, and reporting for 1 year using a fully harmonized approach. The purpose was to collect data on the occurrence in flocks, being the starting point for setting a target for reduction in these populations. Once established, member states needed to present a national control program how they would reach this target. So they could take into account proper production system, but there were a number of EU harmonized requirements, which I will present a little bit later. The target has to be reached within 3 years and still applies today. So they still have to meet this target each year. Once these programs were approved by the Commission, it started. Compliance with the targets has been maintained. And in addition to a harmonized monitoring of the flocks to analyze the trends, comparison between member state and achievement of the target could be evaluated. This data can be found in the annual reports of EFSA and ECDC on zoonosis monitoring. From the start of this control programs, or after some time that we allow member state to reduce the prevalence in the flocks, trade restrictions were introduced when flocks were still infected. In the next slide, you see the outcome of the baseline survey in laying hens in 2004-2005. So you see here that the prevalence was quite high. The EU prevalence was about 30% of the flocks were positive for Salmonella, enteritidis, or Typhimurium. And you see also quite a huge difference between member states. And you see that the last member states, the member states with the lowest prevalence, are all from the north of Europe. So apparently in the north of Europe, it's easier to control Salmonella, or there has been a bigger awareness of Salmonella, and programs had been introduced already to deal with it. Next slide. So these are the targets set in flocks of adult laying hens. They needed to be reached by 2008, and they're still applicable. At national level, in a country, in a member state, maximum 2% of the flocks were allowed to be positive for Salmonella enteritidis or Salmonella Typhimurium. But because of the huge difference between member states, with some having at the start 70% infected flocks, there were some intermediate targets, which were in fact an annual reduction by 10 to 40% of the prevalence compared to the preceding years. You see also how the monitoring of flocks is continued during a harmonized approach. That still applies today. So samples need to be taken 3 times during rearing and every 15 weeks during production by the farmer, by the operator himself. In addition, there are a number of official controls. So there are inspections, and at that occasion, samples are taken and analyzed for the presence of Salmonella. Next slide. Here you see the prevalence in broiler flocks in the baseline survey that took place a little bit later. You see that the prevalence of Salmonella enteritidis is lower. I forgot to mention that for the laying hens, almost all Salmonella were enteritidis Typhimurium. In broilers, there are other serotypes like Infantis and Haddar that also emerge, and the percentage of flocks infected with Salmonella enteritidis Typhimurium was around 11%, so much lower than in laying hens. But here again, you see quite a variation between member states with a little bit the same trends, lower prevalences in the north of Europe compared to the south of Europe. Next slide. And these are the targets for the flocks of broilers. So the target is again on these two serotypes, Enteritidis Typhimurium. That's in fact for all poultry population. It's only these two serotypes for which there are targets. And maximum 1% of the flocks was allowed to be positive and so on. The verification by sampling has happening again by the operators, and each time before a flock went to the slaughterhouse, samples has to be taken within 3 weeks. So we try to do it as late as possible, but the result has to be available before the chickens go to the slaughterhouse so that the slaughterhouse can take that into account and apply, for example, logistic slaughter or, if possible, deviate the meat for heat treatment. Here also, there are a number of official controls which apply that competent authority has to carry out and do also some sampling of flocks. Next slide. So although the measures are mainly developed by the member state, a number of control measures are harmonized at EU level. I mentioned also already the harmonized monitoring that was you saw examples in the previous slides. What we also said is that vaccination is mandatory if the prevalence in flocks of layers is more than 10% for Salmonella enteritis. So then, if you had that, you were obliged to vaccinate until you have an annual prevalence below 10%. So a lot of member states immediately started vaccination because they had a lot of high prevalence of Salmonella. But today, none of the member states is still above 10%. They are around or below the target of 2%. Still, a lot of member states decided to continue vaccination because they're really convinced that this is a measure that can avoid the spread of Salmonella in these flocks. Another issue is that you cannot use antibiotics in flocks to control Salmonella, not for the control themselves. Of course, if the animals are ill because of Salmonella or because of something else, of course you can treat them with antimicrobials, but you cannot use them to reduce your prevalence of Salmonella. This is because it would result in false negative sampling because you get a temporary stop of the accretion of Salmonella. In addition, it would result in more antimicrobial resistant Salmonella. When the flocks are still positive, I'm now talking about the eggs. The eggs cannot be placed on the market anymore as hatching eggs or as table eggs, so eggs for consumption. The eggs from breeding hens and from laying hens, which in flocks which are still infected with Salmonella enteritis T. famulorum, they can only be placed on the market as class B eggs. And this is eggs that are for breaking and processing into egg products subject to pasteurization, where the Salmonella is then eliminated. Next slide. The control measures on the poultry meat are on this screen. They're in another regulation, or regulation on microbiota criteria. We have a process hygiene criterion, which says that which includes Salmonella sampling on carcasses after chilling. Each week, 5 samples has to be taken. During a 10-week period, you achieve then 50 samples in each slaughterhouse, and there is a tolerance of 5. So 5 may be positive, 10% may be positive. If you are above this 10%, you have to take corrective actions with regard to your hygiene. So improve the hygiene in your slaughterhouse to avoid cross-contamination, or you may go back to the holding of the farm that delivered the chickens and try to do something there that the chickens are not contaminated when they come to the slaughterhouse. In addition, if you have positive samples, you have the obligation to check for the food safety criterion. So to check if they are not positive for Salmonella enteritis T. famulorum. Because if this is the case, the meat has to be withdrawn from the market. It can be heat treated and placed on the market anymore, but it cannot be placed on the market as fresh meat. And for completeness, in the EU at this moment, there is not one single authorization of a decontamination agent for poultry meat or for carcasses. Next slide. Here you see the result of the Salmonella measures in human cases. So this is the trend that we have seen for human cases. I mentioned already the figure from 2005 with about 176,000 reported human cases. And this is the trend that we have seen until the last report that has been published by EFSA and ACDC, which was from 2019. So you see that we have quite some good results in the beginning, a quick drop of number of human cases was observed. But the last, let's say the last 6-7 years, there seems to be a trend. We seem to stay at the same number of human cases each year, about 90,000 reported cases. Next slide. The same trend, in fact, you see also in the flock that we monitored. So you see here in green the flocks of laying hens, that is the highest prevalence that we still see. The other green line is from the breeding hens, and then the other colors are from broilers, breeding turkeys, and fattening turkeys. You see that in the same reduction we saw in human cases, in the same period, you see mainly a reduction in breeding hens and more particular in laying hens. We had very good results there, very quick reduction in the prevalence. While again, the last 6-7 years, and in this mainly in meat producing flocks, the decreasing trend is a little less obvious. Next slide. Again, some data from outbreaks, because as I said, this is very important to see the sources which are still causing salmonella in humans. On this slide, you see the data from 2005 again, and I added the same data from 2012 and 2019. So in 2000, and was a substantial reduction in 2012 already. You see the biggest effect between 2005 and 2012, but the further reduction was still observed in the number of outbreaks between 2012 and 2019. This is also reflected in the number of human cases. So these are the human cases involved in an outbreak, not the total, which was reduced also from about 200,000 to 90,000. Human cases involved in outbreaks was reduced from 26,000 to 9,600. At the same time, you have a comparison of the table of the sources of these outbreaks in 2005 and 2019. Perhaps a little bit strange is that you don't see a reduction in the percentage of outbreaks caused by eggs of egg products. It's 37% in both cases. But of course, you have to take into account the total number of outbreaks. So there was about only 1/3 of the number of outbreaks in 2019. So in fact, eggs and egg products were only in 1/3 of the cases the cause of an outbreak in 2019 compared to 2005. In other sources, there was a relative increase. Okay, again, take into account the fact that the total number of outbreaks has been reduced. But for example, pig meat has become far more important as a source of outbreaks. And perhaps you could have the indication, if you compare 1.4 to 8.1, that it has even become more important than in 2019 than in 2005. Next slide. So what kind of conclusion could we draw, or do we draw ourselves a little bit from our experience with the Salmonella control program? Perhaps first the good things, where we think we were successful. We think that the control in laying hens in the first place contributed most to the reduction of human cases. You see reduction in the same period in the flocks and in the human cases. Salmonella enteritidis is mainly found in flocks of laying hens, and that's where you saw the reduction. So we are quite convinced that our control program in flocks of laying hens was successful. Probably less more successful than in broilers or in fattening turkeys, for example. The breeding hens was also fine, but that's already something we are controlling for quite some time. We believe that the major improvement came from vaccination, especially if you have high prevalences. The reduction that we saw in a number of member states, which started with a very high prevalence with 50% or more, was really spectacular by starting a vaccination program. We think that vaccination, that of course has to be carried out carefully, is an important factor if you want to have a quick, good result from salmonella control, and if you are starting from a quite high prevalence. We also have the impression that we got success in reducing salmonella before the measures apply. We think that this was due to the awareness of farmers, because, of course, in the years before that, there were a number of consultations, and it was in the press that there would be more controls on salmonella and so on. So I had the impression that the farmers became aware and started to take biosecurity measures to not to be in troubles, because they would know if they would keep on having salmonella, that at a certain moment there would be trade restrictions. Still, I think that trade restrictions are essential to motivate the farmers to keep on taking all necessary measures. What was also a little bit strange is that we did not set a target or took trait reduction or introduce trait reductions for all Salmonella serotypes, only for two. The reflection behind that was that we don't want to create an incentive that was too high, that had too high economic consequences by setting a trait reduction for all Salmonella serotypes, only for those two that were of the highest importance, most reported from humans. Taking into account that if you take biosecurity measures or measures to avoid these two serotypes, you in fact take biosecurity measures avoiding all kind of Salmonella. And that we have seen a reduction of all kind of serotypes of Salmonella. Next slide. Well, as a conclusion, what were the weaknesses or where could we improve a Salmonella control program? I think you see that from the figures from 2019, that still a lot of outbreaks are from eggs, from infected flocks of laying hens. And if samples are only taken every 15 weeks, as we do today, of course, if an infection occurs, it can take quite some time before it is detected. And if you see that together with the second weakness, that sampling by the farmers may not always be reliable, you can give him training, but okay, he has to be willing to take the appropriate samples and may try to avoid a positive diagnosis. It's for sure that we are missing a number of diagnoses, and that explains why we still have a number of outbreaks by X. Of course, the only way to solve this is to have more official controls, and that means more resources. And that's, of course, something we are not, of member states are still a little bit reluctant to increase the number of official controls. What we also have in our control program is there's not a direct link between the detection of Salmonella enteritis tufomirum in the flocks of broilers and turkey hens and the trait restriction. The trait restrictions are on the meat. So that means even if a flock is positive, we can only impose trait restriction if we also find the serotypes in the meat. And what I did not mention, because my presentation is on poultry, we did also do a baseline survey on patterning pigs and breeding pigs with the intention to consider also targets for reduction. So we did the baseline survey, but then we did do a cost-benefit analysis indicating that this probably would not work. You cannot kill a whole herd of breeding pigs like you do for laying hens or for breeders. So therefore, we did not proceed. So, and you can see from the figures from 2019 that the pigs are for sure becoming more and more important in the occurrence of Salmonella in causing salmonellosis in humans. Next slide is just to thank you for your attention. So I hope that you can do something with this information and that it has a source of inspiration for whatever you're planning on Salmonella control. Thank you.